To join your chat channel. Meanwhile, why don't you invite your friends, relatives, and families? Don't hesitate to share the information at your social media channels and also send SMS message via WhatsApp, Telegram, Signal. See you soon! Dr. Zero right now joins to Spain. So from Spain, we will talk to Brenda Royas Delgado. Hi, Brenda. Welcome.
Hi, Sardar. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Thank you very much for accepting. You have PhD in energy systems, but can you please tell us briefly what you have done PhD? What was your PhD about?
Yes, my main focus on my PhD studies were renewable energies, mostly related to non-dispatchable renewable sources, such as photovoltaics, wind, and wave energy.
Perfect. You are actually from Venezuela, but you were in Spain, yes. And I know temporarily you came to Sweden also. I would like to hear from you. What type of challenges are there after life after PhD?
One of the main challenges I have faced after finishing my PhD or even prior to was maintaining my legal status. You see, I am from Venezuela and I need a visa to stay in the European Union, but my visa was attached to my PhD studies. And once they were finished, my legal status was over, theoretically. And what I had to do to maintain it is to get a freelance permit. That was really brand new permit in Spain. So I managed to get it, presenting my PhD thesis into the Ministry of Industry. So they gave me the freelance permit for 2 years.
So the one challenge is legal status. The other challenge?
The other challenges are, for example, that when you apply for a job, I took the advices of fellow PhD friends of mine, and they say, if you want to get a job, start applying 1 year later, earlier, I meant. I did, but when apart from facing the legal status thing that no non-company was willing to sponsor my visa, I had to face the challenge of being overqualified or considering that, according to recruiters, my PhD experience was not a real job.
So they think and it was quite a real difficult job, even though, but
according to them.
But isn't it like a real job actually? Because it is not only taking courses, you have to run projects, you have to do real experiments, you have to do real calculations.
Yes, actually, when you get the PhD permit, you get a work permit instead of a student permit. That if it's not this consideration giving the status of a job, I don't know what else. And apart from that, you're right, you're running projects, you're not running budgets, but you're running projects, and you are delivering advancements in real industry problems. And they say, but you were applying this knowledge in academia instead of companies. But it's the same. You're facing real problems, either in academia, either in private companies. It's the same.
Yes, I understand. Is there another challenge that after PhD somebody can face?
Yes.
You're talking about overqualification. What do you mean with overqualification?
Yes. Overqualification means that when you get a PhD, you are considered having more studies than the average people. The average people in Spain can get one or two master studies. And doctorate PhDs are not that common. And because of that, you are considered overqualified. And they do not hire you because they prefer to hire someone who earns less than you for doing the same job.
I understand. So, is there anything more?
Yes, there is another challenge we have to face, the underqualification. The underqualification is when you have to chop experience from the resume to get a job in your in there in which your qualifications are not even considered, and of course, in consequence, you're being paid less.
Okay, so is it meaning that you don't tell them you have PhD, or you hide that you, or you get a job that doesn't require any PhD?
There is a lot of people that they hide. They hold a PhD, but here in Spain, it's not that easy to hide that. Actually, I do not recommend people to hide that they are holding a PhD. On the contrary, if you don't want to mention your PhD status, you can say, okay, I'm a junior, I'm willing to learn, I'm willing to do something different from my PhD studies in order to get the job and doing things well.
I understand.
Because
So,
hiding your PhD is the same as lying.
yes, you're right. It is also interesting when the society and these people, they invest so much time and resources to gain some skills, but with those skills, they are not able to get a job and they have the legal status problem. So it is really so sad, I think.
Yes, that's why most of the people, once they get the PhD, they leave the country because there are better opportunities for them when they hold a PhD outside Spain.
So do they go, for example, USA or UK or?
Mostly inside the European Union because there are supposedly better opportunities in the Netherlands, in Sweden, and UK and so on. After Brexit thing, I don't know right now how is the thing with PhD people.
Okay,
But
thank you very
inside the
much.
European Union is
Inside the
okay.
European Union. Thank you very much for joining from Spain. I wish you good luck with your job, and I hope you will get the research position. It is great to have you at this show.
Thank you so much again for inviting me. And when you anytime, I'm here for
I'll be glad
another
to host you
segment.
again. I'll be glad to host you again. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Dr. Zero right now will go to Västerås, a small city in Sweden, to talk to senior lecturer Professor Kamran Namdar. Welcome, Professor.
Thank you so much. Very happy to be with you.
Thank you very much for joining. This is the second time you come, and we had very nice, fruitful discussion. So right now, my question is, we had this pandemic, and we started to reflect about many things in our lives, and then education system has changed also. What did we learn from this pandemic from the perspective of education?
Yes, that's a very good question, and maybe even not just what have we learned, or rather, what should we learn from this pandemic? What is the message that it brings us? I think there are a few important points. One thing that we have, I think, understood in connection with this pandemic is that it is something that affects and touches us all human beings all around the world, and not just that it affects us as it were separately, but as a interwoven global system, as humanity really. I was just listening recently, as you probably have also, to the Secretary General of the United Nations, who was talking about the fact that if you don't see to it that this pandemic is taken care of all around the world, if you only focus on our own countries, that being the richer countries, then that will actually sort of come back to us. So there is no, as it were, selfish solution to this situation. So I think what this pandemic should have helped us realize, if you haven't done it yet, is that in our development as humankind, we have come to a point where we are really an mutually interdependent entity, that we are really, as humanity, like a human body, where all the different organs and cells are interrelated. And you cannot say that, okay, as long as my little finger is healthy, it doesn't matter if the rest of my body is dying of cancer. That would be a very silly way of thinking. But unfortunately, traditionally, our societal and political thinking is very much based on, at the very best, on this idea of a national, our national well-being being, and our national prosperity being the most important consideration.
If you need to take the phone, no problem. I will cut it.
No. I don't want to take the phone. I just want to make it quiet. Yeah. I'm sorry. Do you want to take us again? I didn't realize it.
No problem. You can take from the when it starts to ring. From there, start it a little bit before. I will cut it. I will embed it. Don't worry. No stress.
Okay. I don't remember exactly what I
you
said. But
we cannot say
our own country.
Selfish.
Yeah. Just a second. I will just make sure that I'm very sorry. I will make sure the telephone is off. Just one second, please.
Hey, you use the phone, okay?
No, it's I'm not using the phone. I just want to be able to move around here. Okay, now the telephone should be silenced. Okay. Yeah, so I think that if you haven't realized it yet, this pandemic should have made it clear to us that in our development as humankind, we have come to a point where we really are interdependent. We are one interdependent entity, very much like the human body, where the different organs and cells are all dependent on each other. And you cannot think that, okay, as long as my little finger is fine, the heck with the rest of the body. That would be a very silly way of thinking. But yet that is the kind of logic that we are still used to, thinking of the well-being of our own people, our own nation, in the first instance, and thinking that prioritizing that or ensuring that even at the cost of the well-being of others would bring us prosperity and happiness. And even in the most superficial sense, that is not true. Mm-hmm. So I think that is one of the very important messages for our educational system, that it should prioritize imparting to young people, to the young generation, a sense of oneness of humanity, mm-hmm. of global solidarity, of the fact that we are all really citizens of one world. One could even say that you know, in many senses, the world has become like, or we should look at the world as one country, and that we are all citizens of this one mm-hmm. country, one that entity called Earth. Now, this is of course as I mentioned, it's a vision, it's an understanding that is not directly linked to the existing reality. Now, it's very interesting that if you think of the origins of mass education in the West, which started in the middle of the 19th century in Europe and then in America, and then it spread around the world. Now, one of the main purposes of this mass education was actually to consolidate the nation state. In Europe, some of the remarkable nation states were quite young, for instance, Germany or Italy at that time. But anyway, I mean, all nation states, they existed, but they wanted to use public education as a means of consolidating the loyalty of the citizens. That's why, you know, love for your country and loyalty to the king. These were very central themes in public education. So, and even when democracy became an issue, well, there was a democratic system that was maybe, for instance, in America, was John Dewey, a very famous educational philosopher, spoke very much about the importance of education in strengthening democracy, because democracy was still relatively new in that country. But the whole point was that there was a societal system, and public education was used to consolidate it and confirm it. Now, today,
so it is not to
they're...
educate them, train them, but it is to make them loyal to the state, and maybe
make them adjust and adjust to the existing system and to maintain the existing system. Now this, I think this sort of approach has remained with schools up to our days. And even today, we are, in the best case, we are educating the young generation in order to fit into the society that exists. So we want them to become later on adults that will function in the kind of democracy that we happen to have in our country. We promise them that if they come to our school, they will get good training, and then they go on to university. And universities also, they try to attract students by saying that, you know, if you come to our university, you have a very high chance of getting a good job at the end. Mm-hmm. So it's all like we are trying to produce these very well-polished and fine cogs for an existing machinery. Now, I think that the challenge that we are in, and the great task and opportunity and potential that the educational system is facing today is to do exactly the opposite. Is to become, and this is a vision that great educational thinkers, in a way even from the times of Plato, but certainly people like Comenius or later on the so-called reconstructivist educationalists such as Theodor Bramall, and in fact, as close to our own days as in the 60s, the well-known Swedish political figure Olof Palme, who in those days was a young minister of education, he sort of coined this phrase of schools being spearheads of development. So the idea was that what we needed in society was not reproduction. It wasn't producing a generation that would adapt to and adjust to the existing system, but rather that schools should become arenas for transformation, for reconstruction, for building a new kind of a world.
In innovation, like we use the term constructive destruction. So maybe there should be constructive disruption also. Something should be disrupted so that we can have something constructive. But right now, you're right. We are just asking people to do some stuff to enter this machinery while we complain about the machinery. But if everybody becomes tools of this machinery, how can we change the machinery?
Fantastic. This is exactly the issue. And you see, today with this pandemic, very many people are saying, okay, let's get the vaccines or whatever, so we can go back to how the situation was before the pandemic, sort of back to the old normal. But I think that would be the worst thing that could happen, because if that old normal had been a very well-functioning setup, then we wouldn't had the pandemic the way we have it today. Because one of the reasons why the pandemic has become so deadly and out of control is that our societies, neither individually and especially not collectively, are not functioning the way they should. Mm-hmm. So we definitely don't want to go back to what we had before the pandemic, but we rather want to see what can we learn from this pandemic and create a future that is going to be much better and different from the past. So this transformative task of education, to me, is the central issue and the realization that as humanity we have really come to a turning point. It's impossible, you know. And for instance, this young Swedish girl Greta Thunberg, who had, has become world famous. This is something that she, as a teenager, understands so well, and she's trying to put it across to adults in positions of power who totally resist it, and she becomes so frustrated because this is exactly what she's saying. She's saying, wake up. We cannot continue anymore along those same lines. More of the same, even in refined forms, is suicidal. We have come to a turning point. We need to change things, and we need to change them fundamentally, not just, you know, innovations and creativity within the existing system. We need innovations and creativity that, as you said, is like system breaking or system changing, just system transforming. So in to use an analogy or a terminology from physical science, we've come to a bifurcation point, which means that we have come to a point in our development where we cannot continue any longer along the same line as we have been and as that we are currently pursuing. We have
nature is reminding us, isn't it? It is enough. Climate change, environmental disasters, this virus, wake up. These are all signals of wake up.
Fantastic. Exactly. Beautifully put. Beautifully put. Exactly. They are the alarm clocks. And you know, this is in itself very fascinating, I think, that, you know, today we live in a world. I often think that if someone would come from, you know, outer space, some intelligent life form, and would look at us as humanity. Now, sometimes people think that I may be an alien because I look like it, but no, I'm not. But I try to take. I try to take their perspective. I think they would be very confused because they would look at humanity and they would look and they would see that, my goodness, we have so much knowledge. We have so much science. We have so much technology. I know it's almost incomprehensible. It is incomprehensible that all our knowledge doubles every 12 hours currently.
This is interesting, yeah.
So, I mean, the amount of knowledge and science that we have is just like huge. And then we look at around us and we see that we still have unresolved problems from centuries back. We have poverty. We have tremendous injustice. We have hunger. We have wars. And then, as you said, added to that, it looks like partially, of course, our science and technology has solved many things, but not everything, not sufficiently. And in addition to what it hasn't solved, it has actually, you know, like sometimes your body has this autoimmune reaction where it sort of turns against itself. And in many ways, our science and technology have turned against us. Because exactly as you said, you know, if you think of this environmental destruction, or if you think of weapons of mass destruction, even if you think of the overuse of social media and so forth, well, these are things which are not healthy for humanity. And yet these were not developed by some, you know, wild primitive tribe somewhere in the world. So I think the question, exactly, highly intelligent, highly educated people. And so I think the question then becomes, like, what is missing here? And I think to me, it's very obvious what is missing. I think the thing that is missing is an ethical, one could even maybe say a spiritual, anyway, an existential perspective. Because I sometimes think that science is like a sharp knife. Mm-hmm. And you can ask the question of, is a sharp knife a good thing or a bad thing?
It depends how you use. Is it?
Beautiful. Exactly. Yes. Exactly. In the hands of a murderer, it's a very bad thing. In the hands of a surgeon, it's a very good thing. It can save a life. So just standing in every street corner and giving out sharp knives to people is not maybe the solution. And so this, the idea of just giving people knowledge, and I'm not saying that we shouldn't give people knowledge. Of course, we should give people knowledge, but we should also teach them how to use this knowledge. Because this knowledge, without a compass, without something that gives it true direction, that makes it a servant of human flourishing and human development can actually turn against us. And I think this is what we lack generally in the world today and in our educational system, is sufficient attention to or even clarity about what are those ethical, what are those existential principles
Thank
that
you
should
very
be
much.
the foundation.
Yeah, thank you very much. It seems we need to reflect upon the way that we educate, the society that we build, and how should we train ethically that would have a unity. It is great to have you. Looking forward to have you as a guest. I really appreciate that you contribute with your knowledge, with your experience. Greetings to Westeros.
Thank you so much for having me. All the best. Bye-bye.
Bye. Hello, everybody. Dr. Zero right now joins to Stockholm, and we have a professor from KTH, Henrik Blomgren. Welcome, Henrik. How are you?
Thank you. I'm fine. I'm fine. Just fine.
Thank you for joining. You had a book that you say, Stop, Nobody Move. It is about digital transformation beyond. So it is a fantastic book. And there... And also, you have your own YouTube channel, and you write a lot about education and then business models. So I just want to ask you, in one instance, you talk about how business models are actually changing the way that we produce music, arts. So
yes.
Can you please elaborate on it?
It's actually rather simple. It's always been that business model affect how we do things. We just don't think about it. And when we change a business model, it also changes the way we act. And I mean, if you take streaming of music, the
yes.
business model there versus Spotify, at least, is that if you're a musician and your song is played 29 seconds, you don't get paid.
Yeah. So no money.
It has to, no money. The money
zero.
Stays at... No money. Zero. Spotify keeps that money.
Wow.
So if you have a Spotify account and only listen to all songs 29 seconds, the musicians will never get anything of your money. Spotify will keep it all. I mean, they must have a cap, and they have decided that 30 seconds is a cap. And that has led to consequences. It has led to songs changing character. So a song today, an intro for a music song, has to make you listen more than 30 seconds. And
mm-hmm.
That is already analyzed. So a song intro today is different. Which means that the business model of streaming is changing how music is played or actually created, even created. And it's actually, if we would have thought about this 10 years ago, we could have figured this out. Because there is a reason why a pop song is 3 minutes long, and it's actually the same. It's the technical format of 45 RPM.
Mm-hmm.
So the format we're using, the business model or the technology, is actually changing far more things than we imagine. Yeah,
but that time it was the maybe technical limitations or
yes.
But now we don't have that technical limitation. It is a
no.
company that dictates the rules.
Correct.
Is it a bit
correct.
Different?
Yeah. Correct. Correct. But it actually was It was a company that directed 45 and 33 RPM too. So
the
technology
same.
Is not decided by itself. It was. If I remember correct, was it MGM and Columbia that could not agree whether we should have 45 or 33, and they divided the market between them. So, but you're right. It's not a technical limitation anymore. And you can see that on digital albums on Spotify. They are far longer than 45 minutes. They could be several hours long if you want to, of course.
I also start to follow some singers. They say, okay, we don't need to create new albums anymore because it doesn't make sense, so we decided to have singles every couple of months or every year. So
yes.
It seems the way that they but when we look like this, because as far as I remember, when we were buying albums, so it was providing information about that time frame of that artist, or maybe at that century or at that country, because it is not a single song, but it was the album that we were able to get the sense. Are we also losing that one too? Because now we start to not recognize any artist as a personality. We just listen one song, and then there is another song that is recommended by Spotify, which is not related to that artist.
Yeah, you could say that the album is a pretty dead idea nowadays. There is no point in an album anymore. Not as it was historically, at least. So yes, the album is gone, but we got other things instead. Playlists.
Yes.
They are pretty long albums. I have one playlist where I collect all new songs I happen to hear. So they're like 300 and 400 songs or whatever. Wow. I just put them there randomly. Yeah,
is there another example that business model is actually changing the way that we consume some
books.
Other things?
Books. Yes. Books. Nearly everything. You just have to look at it.
Yes, once you said that now they decide to make smaller books, like shorter texts. Can you please talk about that one?
No, I mean, if you buy a book today, a physical book, you buy it in a certain situation and you pay per book. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter that much how long the book is. There is some kind of a standardized price for a management book, for instance. But if you sell a book on Amazon, a digital book, and if you use, they have actually several business models, but if you use some of their business models, it's very similar to Spotify. You know, you can have a so-called Kindle Unlimited subscription on Amazon, and then you pay a monthly fee, and then the author gets paid in relationship to how much people read of the book, which they keep track on. And that have led to books changing character, for instance, in average shorter. What's the point of writing a big book nowadays when you don't get more paid than that?
So they look at the number of pages or time that is spent.
I'm not really sure. I haven't digged into it that much. I would guess it's time, but it could be number of pages. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, I don't know where their cap is, but it's probably also capped there. Okay. So maybe the intros, the beginning of a book has to look differently in order to get paid. There are a lot of things that have changed with books just because of the business model and books becoming digital. Covers have changed. Table of content have changed. A lot of things have changed just because of the different business models that we have on digital books.
So
what you actually could say is that the format as such, which is related to the technology as well as the business model, affect the content. That's the point. We just assume that you could change a business model and then keep the same content, but you cannot. You cannot. No. And I have an example in one of the books I've written about. It's about theaters. Maybe you read that part.
Yes, please.
Today you pay. Yeah, I mean, today you pay for going to watching a play, a theater play. And it doesn't matter if you leave or if you stay, you still have to pay. But imagine you would pay per minute. Imagine you would pay per minute. Then theaters would change character pretty rapidly, is my guess.
Definitely. They would have to keep your attention all the time that you want to stay to see what will happen the next, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. So different actors would get promoted, plays, average length of a play would change. And if you, for instance, apply that to you can already see that on Netflix and YouTube, that the length of a movie, why should it be 2 hours long? There's no point in it anymore. It could be either shorter or longer.
I also noticed that, for example, Netflix, they see that the most profitable TV series, if it is two seasons, not longer one. So again, when we have these friends, I don't know how many years, 10 years, 15 years, or other TV series, would have never existed if we had Netflix that time then.
Yeah. And that means a lot. It means, for instance, that when we get self-driving cars, it will not be the kind of cars we have today. It will be different cars.
Yes.
Chew on that one. They will look differently after a while.
Yes.
Education is another example that you really can see nowadays. You know, we have the historical idea of a lecture being 45 minutes, which is a fundamentally crazy idea.
Too long. Based on the Do you think too long or?
Well, you should ask the students what they think. Sometimes it's too short if it's good.
Yes.
but I mean, there is a reason why we have 45 minutes. And it's a historical reason, which is actually physical. You needed 15 minutes to walk to the next lecture room. Mm-hmm. You don't walk into another lecture room nowadays digitally. So why keep 15 minutes break? It's just crazy. There's no point. And I would guess that if we look on digital education in 10 or 20 years ahead, it's not gonna be 15 minutes break. There's no point.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have different kind of breaks. So that will change. And then you could knock on the door of a conference center and ask them, why are you keeping 45 minute sessions and then coffee break? And they do it without knowing why they do it. They just do it because universities started to do it once upon a time. So that's going to change.
But isn't it? I thought it was part of like chit-chat time that we could talk with other people.
Yeah, but
the best part of conferences is these chats.
Yeah, but you could chat all the time during a digital conference. So why have a 15-minute breaks? Why not have 5 minutes breaks or 30 minutes breaks or whatever?
I see.
So my only point is that the structure we have for lecturing today is based on the old physical.
Yes.
And that's going to change. There's no logic in 15 minutes anymore. But you're right. We have adapted to it. So we feel today that we need 15 minutes break to make a coffee break, but we don't. And we're gradually going to change that. It's going to take time.
So bottom line is digital transformation and then new business models are going to change the way we produce, the way we consume what we consume right now. So we don't know when it is going to happen, but we are sure that it is going to happen and it is happening. And maybe this pandemic is pushing it much more further.
Yes. Well, I think that in many cases we can figure out at least hypothesis on how it will look, and then it's just a matter of time before it does happen. I mean, this change of music didn't happen the first year with Spotify. It took some years before it happened. So it's going to take some years to happen in other industries too, but it will happen. That's the point. It will happen. And what it actually means is, it means that a musician has to think differently when they write their songs. And that, I think, is the interesting part here. Authors have to think differently about books. You don't write a book. You shouldn't think about writing a book anymore. If you write a book, it's not a book. It's a living creature.
I don't know if I am right.
Chew on that.
Yes, it is totally different. So it seems that you need to write more books, but shorter books. Because as far as I heard from my Russian friends, Dostoevsky was writing so long books because he was paid per word, per page. So he had to write longer to survive, to make money out of it.
Yeah.
So maybe
it
is the same effect.
You could stretch it further and say that a song is not a song anymore. A book is not a book anymore. A movie is not a movie anymore. A car is not soon a car anymore. It's something else. And then the question is, what is it instead? And I think a better metaphor for a digital book is a living creature.
I see.
It's a better metaphor than seeing it as a physical book.
Yes. Thank you very much for joining. It is a pleasure to have you. I hope you will be my guest in other shows also.
Sure. Be more than happy.
Hi, I hope you had a great time at Dr. Zero Show. And if you want other people to hear it, please follow me at Facebook, YouTube, Twitter. Don't forget to follow Reportare and don't forget to follow Dr. Zero Show. If you have any suggestions, recommendations, please get in touch with me. I will be glad to communicate with you and listen what you suggest. See you. Bye.